is American educated, okay, did all his degrees in the States. He's professor at UCLA, but at the same time now for a moment for over a year in and he's like on a relationship of actions from here to you to Penang. And he was talking about his specialization. Most of his work is on India, but he says he's going beyond India and into the field that he's going to talk about, right? So I don't want to take up too much time, but I'll let you proceed.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, I think that rather than reading out the paper, because this is a very small audience, it's actually the smallest audience I think I've spoken to in a long time, I think that it might be better if I actually speak with you and engage in a conversation. So I'm not really going to formally read from the paper. There may be portions that I might read out once in a while. Much of this paper is actually new. I've been working on this question for a long time, and this paper will be given at an EU-sponsored conference actually in Romania next month, which is where I'm going to be reading out the paper. But there are portions of it which are absolutely fresh, and in fact, I only mailed it to Dr. Trumbly last night. You know, Rashida, all right. Thank you. So let me begin by saying the following: that the ideas here will seem, I think, distinctly radical to you, because particularly given my own background, which is that I am, as has been mentioned in the introduction, educated entirely in the U.S. And so I have an intimate familiarity with the American educational system, of course. But my view is that the American educational system has now become globalized in ways that we have to be very cautious about. But it's not only the American educational system, it's the whole question of Eurocentrism, which is not a term that I actually am very fond of, because I think it's been trivialized, and I think that we tend to use it much too frequently, but there are very specific ways in which it can be deployed, I think, successfully and with intelligence. And let me begin with a little narrative about an early 19th century text, which I do not discuss in the paper, to give you an illustration of the depth of the problem. In the early 1820s, James Mill, the father of John Stuart Mill, who became more famous than his father, okay, but nonetheless, James Mill was a very famous man himself. So James Mill authored a huge, voluminous work. It's called The History of British India. The first edition came out about 1820. Throughout the 19th century, this book was absolutely required, mandatory reading for all the civil servants who were running the British Empire in India. It was a standard text. It became highly influential. And James Mill, some of you may know, was also one of the founding fathers of the school of thought known as utilitarianism, along with Bentham, Jeremy Bentham. Both James Mill and John Stuart Mill, I might say, spent their entire adult working lives in one job, frankly, and that was with the East India Company, where James Mill was in the office of the examiner of correspondence, that's what it was called, which meant that when correspondence, and you have to remember this is the 1820s we're talking about, so generally a letter written by the British civil servants in India would take about 2 months before it would reach India, and it would reach the office of the examiner of correspondence. And then James Mill eventually became the chief examiner of correspondence. And his son succeeded him in that position. And this, incidentally, is interesting because there has long been a Western view that in India there is a lot of nepotism. Now, whether the Indians learned the nepotism from the British or the British learned it from Indians is an interesting question, considering that both James and John Stuart Mill had exactly the same position and worked with the East India Company for their entire adult lives. Okay? But the main thing is this, that the History of British India that was James Mill authored is basically divided into three periods, right? He calls the first period the Hindu period, And he also designates it as the ancient period. The middle portion of Indian history is what he calls the medieval period, and he also calls it the Mohammedan period, because certainly in North India, you had Muslim dynasties. Less so in South India, although there were portions in South India you had the Deccan Sultanates, as they were called, but in North India from about 1100 AD, much of the country started to come under Muslim dynasties. And these dynasties were basically from Afghanistan, Central Asia, and beyond, Turkey, right? Now, he designates the third period, the modern period. Okay, so ancient, medieval, modern. But he calls it also the British period. Now, this is where the cunning of reason takes place. Because if Mill had written in complete honesty, he should have termed that period the Christian period. Because in fact, the rulers of India were Christian. They believed themselves to be Christian. And they believed that they were bringing the blessings of Christian civilization, not just Western civilization, to India. So if you have the Hindu period, you have the Mohammedan period. And notice, by the way, that Mohammedan and medieval are cognate terms for Mill. And the word medieval in the English language is not an innocent word at all. It is not at all an innocuous word, because medieval simply doesn't mean middle. It means actually somebody who has a mindset which goes back, okay, which is in some ways in the Dark Ages, which was the European Dark Ages, because of course what James Mill did was he used the template of European history and he immediately planted it on to Indian history. There is of course also the question as to why this kind of periodization became adopted all over the world. I mean, is there something universal or natural in dividing periods of history into ancient, medieval, okay, and modern, right? And yet, this periodization of history, it seems to me, has become almost entirely universal. If you study the history of China, India, Africa, this is the template that is invariably used, okay? So one problem is a question of templates. A second problem, okay, there's several distinct problems that arise from this simple example, okay, but I'm going to just lay them out for you. One is the problem of periodization and how this form of periodization was universalized. Secondly, there is the cunning of reason, as I've said to you, namely that there is the pretense that Britain has become secular, and therefore he cannot designate this modern period as Christian, you see, right? But of course we know that it's only secular in the way in which the United States is secular, that yes, I mean, there may be a separation of church and state, but you cannot be elected to the presidency of the United States unless you are a member of a Christian church. Tacitly, this is well understood in the United States. Not a single president that has been elected to the United States is not a member of some Christian church. I mean, there have been one or two people who were members not of a Protestant church. Kennedy is the most well-known example. He was a Catholic, but you still had to display your public religiosity. Okay? So there is this cunning of reason that takes place, right? And then, as I said, there's this third question, whereby it's not simply a matter of saying that, okay, well, Britain has now become secular. Mill is assuming that there is a distinction between the public and the private, because at the same time that Mill was writing, the East India Company had changed its charter to allow Christian missionaries to work in India and to proselytize, exactly at the same time that Mill was writing his history of British India, right? Now, Mill essentially takes the view that Britain has reached that state where it can make a distinction between the public and the private, that you can have a religion, but this religion is strictly your private affair. It cannot be a public affair. Although, in fact, of course, we know that it was a public affair, and the Christian proselytization that was taking place in India was one good illustration of that. Okay? So there are many, many other, by the way, you know, extrapolations that one may make from this particular narrative that I'm setting out. But the reason I mention it to you is because I'm trying to illustrate to you what I think is the central problem that we need to be thinking about. And that central problem, now I want to rephrase in a very different way. There is an immense literature on globalization. And there are some serious discussions about whether globalization is, for example, as new a phenomenon as we think it is, right? Whether it goes back only to about two or three decades, particularly to the period after the fall of the Soviet Union, okay, the breakup of the Soviet Union, the end of the Cold War, when it seemed that the idea of the free market had now become universalized. Okay, and this was also the period, I mean, shortly after that, there was the NAFTA agreement, the North American Free Trade Agreement, and this is when the Chiapas Rebellion arose on the 1st of January 1993 as a reaction to NAFTA. Okay, the point, I think, is simply this, that there's a school of thought which argues that globalization is a phenomenon that can date to about two or three decades at the most. There's another school of thought which takes a very different view, that there have always been periods of globalization. One good illustration of that, for example, would be the Indian Ocean trading world. From all the way from the 6th, 7th century AD until 1500, when in the South China Sea, in this part of the world, the Malay world, the Indonesian archipelago, of course India, the east coast of Africa, and West Asia, this was all part of the Indian Ocean trading world, beautifully evoked in a book by Amitabh Ghosh called In an Antique Land. And in this world, so for example, if you read accounts of this, you could not go to any place within this world and not run into a Gujarati. The Gujaratis were everywhere. In fact, they had established what we could call was called a thalassocracy, that is a seaborne cultural empire. And I say cultural empire because the Gujaratis weren't carrying arms, okay? They went as merchants, right? But they were found to be found everywhere. I mean, there are ethnographic records which show the presence of these Gujaratis all over, right? And they're not the only trading group that are involved there, but they're a good illustration of that, right? And this might be an illustration of globalization, because the globalization means in part the free, unhindered access of goods, okay? Right? And that's, of course, not the only thing it means by any stretch of the imagination, but if that's one of the things it means, okay, certain patterns of exchange, then certainly we could say that between the 6th and the 15th century it was to be found in the Indian Ocean world, and there might be other similar words as well. Now, that illustration might seem a bit too remote. I think that the first instance of globalization in the modern world is a slave trade. Because African slaves were transported to nearly all parts of the world, with consequences, of course, that were disastrous for the Africans, right? But the slave trade is a very good illustration. It involved huge numbers of middlemen, okay? And there was certainly immense kind of profiteering that took place from this kind of trade. Now, let's not be detained, however, or derailed by the question of when globalization started, because the thesis I want to put forward to you is a very different one. What I want to suggest is that globalization doesn't simply mean the fact that certain icons and certain institutions and certain goods become globalized. McDonald's. You can go everywhere in the world and there's a McDonald's, right? Just as you could go everywhere in the world at one point and there was a Gujarati, right? So McDonald's, right, MTV, right? Certain kinds of consumer goods, Japanese animation games, right? All of these are things that have been globalized. But my thesis to you is, in fact, that the thing that has been most effectively globalized without our being aware of it in the slightest instance is knowledge systems. That a certain style of thinking, a certain form of thinking became globalized. Paul Samuelson wrote an economics textbook. He's well known for those of you who are economists. If there are any, you would know him. I mean, he's a well-known economist. A friend of mine once also wrote an article on him describing him as a fascist. We won't get into the details of that because that's an argument that could be made probably of many economists if you follow the trend of my thinking here, okay, which I'm going to lay out for you in due course of time. The point simply is this, that Paul Samuelson wrote an economics textbook which was the industry leader, as they say, for four decades. For four decades, this was the economics textbook that was used. It was used in 80 countries, including constitutional monarchies, liberal democracies, autocratic states, totalitarian states, despotic states. Okay, translated into 44 languages, right, and sold upwards of 25 million copies. Paul Samuelson. Now, this is what it means to be globalized. It's not simply Harry Potter that's globalized. Okay, it's Paul Samuelson. And when Paul Samuelson's economics textbook gets globalized, it has enormous consequences. Because what it means is that we all follow the same recipe for what is considered to be economic growth. Okay, because it has now been laid down in this textbook. And there is this whole problem of textbooks. Right? The culture of textbook, that's yet another issue which we have to table aside for the moment because it's not central to my argument, but I would like to for you to simply think about it. Because one of the things that you would have noticed, if you reflect on it for a little while, is that there is an intrinsic relationship between the nation state and the culture of the textbook. One of the first things that a nation state does when it comes into existence is it starts creating a new series of textbooks. Okay. That's one of the first things it does, particularly in history, because one of the ambitions of the nation state is to create an authorized version of the history of the nation coming into being, the authorized history of the freedom struggle. Okay? And in my view, the textbook is one of the most dangerous sources of knowledge. It's widely accepted in every culture. It's used in every culture. There isn't a single country that I know of that doesn't have a culture of textbooks. And it is not an accident that some of the most bitter disputes, ideological disputes, have been over the content of history textbooks, particularly. These ideological disputes that I know in very great detail, in at least four countries that I know of in great detail, include Japan, where the Chinese had objected very strongly, particularly to, for example, Japan's admission of its role or otherwise in World War II, you know, its role in promotion of comfort women, so forth and so on. The United States, okay, India, right? These are examples that, you know, I could discuss in very great detail during the Q&A period if somebody had any interest in it. But I'm simply giving an illustration here. I'm saying that there's an intrinsic relationship between the nation state and the culture of the textbook. Okay, when did the idea of the textbook arise? Where did it arise? Why is it that we all fell into the habit of using the textbook? Okay, right? And who authorizes a textbook, with what consequences, with what authority, right? And so forth and so on. There's a whole series of questions over there. But again, as I said, I want to put it just on the table, but it's a bit of an aside, because my fundamental argument here now, right, is that what has been most effectively, most insidiously, most passively globalized are the knowledge systems of the modern West. Right? And here, the illustration that I've given is the illustration of Paul Samuelson's textbook, but I will now give further illustrations. All right, so this is a general lay of the field that I want to sort of look at. Now, let me go back to World War II, okay? The end of the war. Because the end of, in some ways, World War II was like any other war. In some ways, it wasn't. It was like any other war because, frankly, it was actually largely a European war. I mean, A.G.P. Taylor wrote a book where he said that this whole idea of describing World War I as a world war is a bit absurd because, frankly, it's European powers contesting for supremacy. Now, we know, of course, that World War II, the picture gets more complicated because you have a war in the Pacific with Japan being one of the main aggressors as well. But Japan here was, of course, by the way, emulating the militarism, which it had formerly renounced, by the way. You know, there's a very interesting book, it's called When Japan Gave Up the Sword, of how Japan actually gave up the culture of militarism in the 15th, 16th century, and then embraced it again after the Meiji Restoration, okay, when it started to have ambitions to become a world power. Right? Nonetheless, the point is this, that in some respects, World War II is also different. It's different because it shows the nature of total war, which in some ways commenced in World War I when you had the brutal, senseless killing of millions of young men in trench warfare. Okay, for example, in the Low Countries, okay, where you've spent some time, you know, in the Low Countries, right, Belgium, Poland, and so on, Luxembourg, that area, right? Okay, now World War II was also different because it ushered in a new kind of technology. And we have to remember that the atomic bombs that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and again, there's a huge literature on this, and I'm basically giving you my point of view in half a minute. There is a school of thought which I subscribe to, which holds that these bombs were not simply dropped in order to compel the submission of the Japanese, because the Japanese had been pretty much reduced at that point to rubble. Okay, the idea of the bombs was to send a message to the Soviet Union. Okay, this is one of the reasons, principal reasons, why the bombs were dropped at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. So the intent was always to look to the Soviet Union, because it seemed, from the American standpoint, that the Soviet Union was set on a course of world domination. Now that you had defeated Nazism and fascism, now you would have to contend with communism. That was the American point of view, right? All right. But for the purposes of this argument, there are two things for the purposes of my paper, we need to think about two things about World War II. One is, there was some kind of radical reorganization of knowledge that took place, to some extent, because the whole idea of area studies was an American invention following the conclusion of World War II. You carve up the world. Now, of course, this was a different way of carving up the world, because that's what the Europeans had done for a very long period of time. What else had they done for the last 400 years except to carve up the world? And in fact, in the late 15th, early 16th century, they even had the blessings of the Pope. When Spain and Portugal went to the Pope and they received what's called a papal bull, which said, all right, you, to Spain, you have this portion of the world, and to Portugal, you have the other portion of the world, right? That's carving up the world. Now there was an academic carving up of the world, where the Americans decided that they were going to carve it up, so there were going to be distinct areas of study, Southeast Asia, okay, South Asia, you know, the Middle East, as they called it. It was never called the Middle East by anybody else. It was always called West Asia, right? I mean, when did it become the Middle East, if you think about it, right? So, and here is a problem that I'm going to talk about later on. I'm just alerting you to it. This is what I call the imperialism of categories. That one of the things we have to think about when we think about knowledge systems is we have to think about what kind of categories they set up and how these categories create a certain imperialism when they become dominant. Okay? Right? But leave that aside for a second. Just you can mull over it, because that will be one of the central, you know, portions of the paper that I'm going to talk about. What I want to do here is suggest that there was this radical reorganization of knowledge with respect to area studies. And one of the consequences of that, which the Americans would realize when 9/11 occurred, okay, was that a place like Afghanistan somehow fell through the cracks when they had this radical reorganization of knowledge. Because Afghanistan was not viewed as a part of South Asia. South Asia meant India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Nepal, Sri Lanka. Okay, that's what it meant. And you know, smaller countries such as Bhutan and Maldives that nobody knows anything about. Okay, right? This was South Asia. Then there was Southeast Asia, which included Malaysia, Indonesia, Singapore, Vietnam, and so on. And then there was the Middle East. But the Middle East did not include Afghanistan. Okay? You see, so if you were doing Middle East studies in the United States, you were not doing Afghanistan. And when 9/11 occurred, there was only one specialist in the United States, one, who knew Pashto. One specialist who knew Pashto in the entire American military academic establishment. Okay? So think about it, right? I mean, and this is, of course, they realize that this is, you know, you carve up the world and somehow Afghanistan, as I said, fell through the cracks. All right? This was one consequence of it. The second thing that I wanted to talk about with respect to World War II is that we have to think of it in this way, and this is where the question of knowledge comes in. The Europeans actually did to themselves what they had been doing to everybody else for the last 300 years. Okay? And in order to understand that, I want to suggest to you that we need to think, when we think about, you know, Orientalism, for example, which many of us are familiar with, that in fact Europe orientalized not only the Orient, it orientalized much of itself. And that portion of Europe is called Eastern Europe. There is a book that I would recommend to you by Larry Wolf called Inventing Eastern Europe, which is an extraordinary study which shows how Eastern Europe provided the first model of underdevelopment for Western Europe. When people who were considered to be the fount of Western Enlightenment, and I'm thinking here of Voltaire, Diderot, Condorcet, okay? You know, the supreme figures of the Enlightenment. When these people spoke about the Slavs and the Poles and the Gypsies, their face would go red with fury. In other words, to them, these people were savages, barbarians. They were the first model of underdevelopment. You didn't have to go to India to meet the savages, so to speak, or to Africa. You just had to cross the border into something called Eastern Europe. Whatever that border was, it was not, of course, it was a very nebulous border. Where did it begin? Where did it stop? Because Slavic culture, of course, in some ways permeated into Western European culture too, right? But nonetheless, there was a very clear distinction between those who were Germans, Teutons, Anglo-Saxons, those who were considered to be within the sphere of Western Europe, including, of course, people from Italy because the Italian Renaissance and all of that, and some place called Eastern Europe, okay, right? Because throughout this period, and in fact, I would suggest down to the present day, that down to the present day, this area was spoken of with enormous disdain and contempt by people in Western Europe, okay? Now, the consequences then for my argument are this, that when we think about the question of the politics of knowledge systems, the imperialism of categories, who was underdeveloped, so for example, by somebody else, we have to think about how Europe underdeveloped some of its own people before it underdeveloped others, right? And it's important to do that because politically speaking, I think that we should be very cautious about making distinctions simply between the West and us. In other words, there are others within the West who were marginalized, who were brutalized, just as there are people in the non-Western world who in fact actually mentally have always lived in the West. They may not physically live there. You know, one of my books, which was published in 2009, is a book called The Other Indians. It's a study of the Indian diaspora, the worldwide Indian diaspora, right? And you'll see why I'm mentioning this here. In this book, the number of Indians living overseas is estimated to be about 20 million, including those living in Malaysia, Kenya, United States, Canada, Australia, Mauritius, Guyana, and so on. About 20 million. I mean, you could dispute the figure a little bit. Maybe it's 22, maybe it's 18, but somewhere around there. Well, in the concluding chapter of the book, I actually argue that they're 200 million. Now, everybody laughed. Okay, and she said, that's absurd. I mean, there isn't a single statistic that supports that. I said, well, no, but I'm making a very different argument. There are already 150 to 200 million middle-class Indians who are living in cities such as Mumbai and Delhi and Calcutta, who in fact are part of the diaspora. They just simply happen to be living in India. But the way they imagine the world, the kind of food they eat, the festivals they celebrate, they might as well be part of the diaspora. You know, we shouldn't be thinking of some kind of geographical determinism when we think of the idea of the diaspora. They are what I call the resident non-Indians. Okay? The resident non-Indians. You know, and the Indian government has a term called non-resident Indians, which includes people like me. So I'm a non-resident Indian, right? Because I live mainly in the US. But there are 150 to 200 million Indians who are resident non-Indians. Okay? They are, in effect, part of the Indian diaspora. Okay? Because they behave like members of a diasporic community now. Right? So this is the way in which I think we have to extrapolate some of the problems that we think about. Now let me move on very quickly. How much time do I have, incidentally? Just let me know when I should stop, just so that I have some rough...
Until one.
Okay, so another 15 minutes or so. Yeah. All right. Okay, 20 minutes or so.
Q&A as well.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so
right. So now, when I say that what has been most effectively globalized are knowledge systems, okay, what I want to do is I think that that point, I think, has come across well, but I want to give illustrations drawn from different disciplines. Okay, and I want to look at things that we think we understand entirely, common sense terms, and in fact, it's not the case at all. And so I'm going to begin with a little anecdote from my own childhood. When I was growing up in Delhi, and in my adolescent years in the 1960s and early 1970s, the most widely sold books, okay, were the novels of Ayn Rand. Okay, the most widely sold books, and you can Google Ayn Rand today, and you'll find that her novels still sell about a million copies even today. So Ayn Rand is a Russian American. I mean, she's Russian born, and then moved to the United States, and she wrote these two novels, Atlas Shrugged and The Fountainhead, which are basically naked celebrations of greed and self-interest. That's what these novels are about. That the destiny of human beings is to advance their own interest. There is no limit to your greed. Everything is possible. Okay. I mean, that's basically, and it's basically a kind of social Darwinism, because those who are fit will rise to the top, those who are not will fall by the wayside. Right? The other two books that were widely sold, the most widely sold, were two books by a person who works in IQ, okay, intelligence quotient, and these two books were called Test Your IQ and Check Your Own IQ. Isaac is his name, Hans Isaac, okay, widely sold. Again, by the way, a form of social Darwinism, because in my view, this is a completely nonsensical idea, the idea of IQ. This is an idea rooted in 19th century evolutionary social Darwinism. That's what it is. Okay? And one thing I want to suggest now, and this is one way to get into the whole question, is that these ideas that originated in the 19th century entirely survive in our midst today. And we are entirely comfortable with them, even when we think we have completely given up on these ideas. In the 19th century, let me elaborate a bit, and then I'll move into an elaboration of the concepts. In the 19th century, second half of the 19th century, there was a whole field of study that arose called anthropometry. Okay, and anthropometry was where you took measurements of the skull, the size of the skull. You also took measurements between your nose and your navel, okay, and the measurements of the nose. So there was some standard, and there was this thing called the nasal index. It's called the nasal index, developed by Herbert Risley, widely used in the late 19th century, incidentally. Okay, and on the basis of these measurements, a determination was made as to how intelligent you were, whether you belong to the superior races or the inferior races. And of course, you can be quite sure that the white races always came out the most superior according to these measurements. Invariably. I mean, just no question about it. And if you look at the measurements, so you have, you know, the Anglo-Saxons at the top, followed very closely by the Teutons, right? And then you go down to other people, and way down then you're going to find Indians, and below them you're going to find Africans, right? Okay, this was the scale. Right, and then there was a place for everybody within this scale. It was an evaluative scale. Now, of course, in our age of political correctness, by now, and in fact long before that, it became highly discreditable to do science that way. Right, and in fact, the term that was used for this kind of science was eugenics, frankly. Okay, eugenics, which has another component too, because eugenics partly meant that you sorted out the fit from the unfit, and you eliminated the unfit. That's what the Nazis did. Because I hope that all of you know that the Jews were not the only people that the Nazis eliminated. They had a whole campaign to eliminate people that were considered to be mentally retarded, gypsies, and so on. Okay, right? So people who were considered to be unfit in some way or the other were to be eliminated. Okay, and eugenics helped to do that. Right? And eugenics was also used as a pretext for forced sterilization of black people in places like Virginia. Widely documented by people who have looked at these kinds of instances, okay? Right? Now, what I want to suggest is the following, that this idea, in those forms, of course, became entirely acceptable in the post-World War II period. you know, you couldn't do science this way and simply say that, well, depending on the shape and size of your nose and the distance between the nose and the navel, you were so and so. It was really not considered proper science to do that anymore. What we did was we substituted something else in its place. Although most people don't view it that way. This is my view, and this is where you're free to absolutely contest the view. I'm going to suggest two kinds of indices that came up in its place, which have now become so globalized that nobody questions them even remotely. One, the idea of literacy, and second, the idea of development. Okay? Now, there is a difference between the word literacy and the word literate. And this is where you have to go to the Oxford English Dictionary, because the Oxford English Dictionary, which is the etymological dictionary, and it gives you historical instances of how a word has been used over a long period of time, including its first use. The word literate was first used in the 15th century, because you could always make a distinction between those who were literate and those who were illiterate. The word literacy, which is of course cognate to the word literate, was first used in 1890. That's over 430 years after the word literate was first used. Why is that the case? Well, one of the reasons for that is the word literacy is in fact an evaluative scale. So when the UN says that let's see which are the countries that are the most developed and which are the countries that are less developed and those that are lesser developed and those that are the least developed, one of the three principal indices it uses is the index of literacy. You look at the literacy rate. Okay? So, you know, the countries that are most developed generally tend to have the highest literacy rates. Not always. Okay, there are complications here. The complications have arisen from the fact that there are countries such as Nicaragua, which are not that developed in this sense, but have a very high literacy rate, because when the Sandinistas came into power, they made a concerted attempt to improve the literacy rate. Cuba has a 99% literacy rate, frankly. Okay, right? So, you know, but on the whole, the idea is that literacy is an evaluative scale. You judge civilizations, okay, partly by looking at their literacy rate, where you would place a civilization on the rank, on the scale of civilization, because there's always been a scale of civilization. The 19th century had another scale of civilizations too, by the way, right? Very widely used. I mean, not formally, tacitly. And that was, you judge a civilization by how it treats its women. Okay? And this is why India, from the point of view of the British, fell way down, because it had certain practices which the British would consider to be absolutely degraded practices with respect to the life and livelihood of women. Okay? So you judge a civilization by how it treats its women. This was a scale that was used very widely in the 19th century. And the idea was that Europe treats its women the best, and therefore it should be at the top, and then other civilizations don't treat their women too well, and they will fall way below Europe. Okay? Right? So literacy now is an evaluative scale, I'm saying. And it is not an innocuous term. But every country in the world has now come to accept the idea that literacy is one of the ways in which you evaluate a country. Okay? And of course, then you have to ask yourself, if the United States has a 99% literacy rate, why did the bulk of the country allow itself into thinking that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction? I mean, this was a huge fairy tale concocted by the Americans, and they went to war and destroyed a civilization, right? And there was virtually no dissent, virtually. And you had demonstrations here and there. The first Gulf War, 1991, I mean, when I was there as well at that, there was hardly any dissent, right? A large number of Americans can be persuaded to believe that in the national interest, okay, you have to do this or that, right? Now, what does it then mean to be literate if you're not able to make an independent judgment of some kind on your own, right? So in other words, what is the use of something called literacy? Okay? And here I'm not arguing, by the way, that people should not be literate. Okay? So you have to make the distinction. This is not an argument for saying that people ought not to have the basic tools of literacy, because those are one of the basic tools of citizenship today, no matter what kind of citizenship you have. Okay? The other model I want to look at, okay, which I'm suggesting came out of eugenics, okay, is the idea of development, which again is a sanctified idea. No, you know, to contest development, and there are people who have contested it, but they have come up with softer forms of development. So that's why you have this whole language now called development with a human face, alternate development, humane development, right? Because in some ways we understood that the way that development was carried out in many parts of the world, what it did was not be sensitive to local cultures, okay, to the wishes of the people, to the attachment that people might have to their land. I mean, if you look at the three gorges, you know, three river gorges dam project in China, or if you look at the Narmada project in India, right? One of the main arguments that's been made about these projects is that, well, you know, the state doesn't have an adequate rehabilitation policy ever, frankly. Okay, much more fundamentally, if you look at a place like India and you look at the Narmada, the areas that get inundated, okay, are areas where you have a substantial number of people who have a real attachment to their land. And you cannot measure this attachment by money. You can't simply say that this is the value of the land today, okay, and we're going to give you something like a market rate, which, by the way, never happens. A market rate is never given. Okay, they give something of, you know, a rate that they consider to be respectable, and then we're going to transplant you to a place which is 100, 200, 300, 400 miles away. Okay, but the problem is that there is an attachment to the land, and this is, of course, the whole story of Native American culture. Right, that one of the problems with the Native American community today, which is one of the most invisible communities in the world, frankly, is the fact that they no longer retain the kind of association they retain with their land. Okay? Now, development, however, we have to look at it in a more complex way. Okay? Because I'm not simply pointing to these kinds of problems that many other experts have pointed to. I mean, there was a generation of Western experts that at one point, back in the 40s and 50s, thought that none of this really mattered. That if you wanted to have development, if you wanted to move people on to a higher plane, you know, of existence, people had to sacrifice things. Okay? People had to sacrifice things. But I think by the 70s and 80s, even many of these Western experts had come around to the view, because now development projects had been practiced for three decades almost, that there were several unsavory, unfortunate consequences of carrying out development in this way. And this is where the idea of development with a human face, alternative development, all of this actually arose, was out of this kind of thinking in the 1970s, 1980s. My own view is that this critique of development is absolutely inadequate. Because there is a temporal and spatial politics in the idea of development that I think we need to be thinking about. Okay? And this is where the idea of history comes in as well. The bulk of this paper actually is about history, although I haven't even talked about that today at all. Right? What I mean is the following. The idea of development is based on a time lag. It's based on a time lag. So, you are an Indian, you are at this stage of history right now, okay? You're at this stage of history. To be developed means that you have to go to another stage of history, where the Europeans are, and the Americans are, and the Japanese, you know, the honorary whites, as they're known in the development literature, right? Okay? Right? And maybe the Chinese will be added to that in the course of two, three decades, who knows, right? Okay? So, you have to go to that stage. But the time lag is the following, that by the time you get to that stage, that person has already moved on to some other stage. So this, what development is predicated on is what I call the waiting room of history. It's the waiting room of the railway station, okay, where you're constantly trying to play this game of catching on. And that person that you have caught on to now, or you think you've caught on to, has obviously moved to a different phase. Let me put it in a very different language now. Because this also brings us to the question of Orientalism, which is where much of the discussion has taken place in the last three decades, you know, after Saeed's book came out. And there's a very interesting literature also on the question of whether Said was saying something that had or had not been said before by others. You know, and if it had been said by others before, well, how come Orientalism became such a pivotal book? Because certainly I can tell you on the American Academy, there is no question that in the humanities, this has been the single most important book in the last three decades, without a shadow of a doubt. Okay? And highly influential in some of the softer social sciences. When I say softer, I mean anthropology. You know, okay? Right? Highly influential in anthropology, in literature, film studies, the humanities very broadly. There's a whole set of interesting questions which we'll have to table for the moment as to what was Said saying that had not been said before, and in what manner was he saying it, right? The important consideration is the following. Keeping in mind what I said about development and the waiting room, think of it this way, because this also takes us to the question of Orientalism, that when you look at European travelers, and Said talks a lot about European travelers coming to India or the Middle East, right? Because one of the things that he's trying to suggest is that Orientalism is a style of thinking. It's a framework of thinking. And it didn't matter whether you were a traveler or a scholar or an administrator, you all partook of it. Remember, by the way, that James Mill, with whom I started, who wrote the history of British India, never visited India. And some people say that that's why his history is bad. I strongly disagree with that. That's not the reason why it's bad, because there are people who've been to India who wrote books just as bad as Mills. We shouldn't assume that simply experience here is the guide to writing a good book. In fact, you can write a worse book, because then you think you've been there, and so you know, and then you speak from with the voice of experience, right? It was a bookish knowledge, and what Said is arguing is that the knowledge of the travelers and the bookish knowledge were congruent, actually. They all led to the same conclusion about the nature of the Orient and the nature of the people there, right? Okay, and the modes of knowledge they had or didn't have, so on and so forth. But the particular illustration I want to give, which links it up with the time lag problem, is the following. That you see, when a European came to India in the 18th century, they came not necessarily because they were interested in what India looks like in the 18th century. They came because they were interested in what Europe might have looked like in the 16th century. Okay? So in other words, you come to India because there's a time lag. So whatever India is like in 1800 is what Europe was like in 1600. Except that if you're living in Europe in 1800, you can't see what Europe was like in 1600. Okay? So one way to see what Europe is like in 1600 is to go to a place like India. Okay? See, this is, Said, by the way, doesn't really make that argument. This is an argument that I'm making, and this is, I'm saying, think of the idea of development. We think it's basically a post-World War II development idea, okay? And in fact, there's a whole range of literature which has looked at the archaeology of this idea, the archaeology of development. In fact, this idea I'm suggesting to you goes back several hundred years ago, right? And it has two different trajectories. One is the trajectory of eugenics, the nasal index, and then in the middle, you know, the years that I was growing up, things like IQ. What is IQ? It's frankly a form of racism. Because whenever you looked at these books on IQ, they would almost invariably end up with the conclusion that, yes, there were these great people who had great IQs, and somehow they all came from the West. And then there were others who didn't have that kind of IQ, you know. Okay? Right? And development has that trajectory, okay? That you are lesser developed, we are lesser developed, okay? And our destiny, our history, is to live someone else's history. Because the only way I can fulfill my history is actually to get developed, and therefore live your history, not my history. You see? Okay? This is one of the fundamental consequences of this. That was one trajectory of this idea of development. The other is this time lag that I've talked to you about, where I've given you the illustration of the European who comes to India. And India is just an example. It could be Africa. It could be Polynesia. You know? Right? And you have to read the text between the lines to understand that. Right? So what I've attempted to do in my remarks in the last 20 minutes is to give you illustrations of certain categories which are absolutely central to modern knowledge systems. such as literacy, develop, which have been so effectively globalized that there's virtually no dissent about these categories at all. And I want to re-emphasize that, because if someone says, well, no, there is a dissent about the idea of development, not really. The dissent itself has now become packaged, and the experts on development have already taken that into account, which is why all the practitioners of development, all the experts today, all speak about humane development, development with a human face, alternative development. Nobody is recommending some outright development project where you go and you just simply raise a place. Nobody really recommends that. Effectively, you may end up doing the same thing. Okay? So I'm saying that the central problems that we need to think about have to do with the manner in which knowledge systems became globalized. What does it mean to speak about globalized knowledge systems? What it means in effect, and I'm going to use here the words of actually a Malaysian intellectual, Syed Hussein Alapas, when he refers to the captive mind. That in effect, we became and still are, without the shadow of a doubt, captive minds. Because we work entirely within the framework of European. And when I say European here, I'm including, of course, the United States, the Euro-American world. Okay, we work entirely within that framework of knowledge. And one thing that you might want to think about is this, that when people speak about the rise of China, okay, and the fact that China is going to have a global economy which is going to clearly outpace that of the United States, you know, within a few years, right? It is the country that now seems to be on the horizon for everybody. One question that I would like to certainly ask is, what are the categories of thought produced by Chinese social scientists that all of us use, for example? Okay? If you are a Chinese scholar, right? Your word is mediated either by China or by Europe. You're going to end up reading Foucault, Habermas, Derrida, or these are figures, of course, in European, contemporary European philosophy, but if you were doing hardcore science, economic science, then it would be people like, you know, Samuelson and many others, right? These are the people that the Chinese social scientists or philosophers or humanists are going to read. If I'm an Indian philosopher, Indian humanist, my word means India, and then there's something called the West. Nothing else at all exists, frankly. And it is exactly the same story for scholars from Africa, from Latin America. Right? If you're an African scholar, you have obviously some familiarity with your culture, right? And then you have familiarity with something called the West. Everything is going to be mediated through the West. China might have a navy that is going to go into the blue seas. It might produce the latest generation of fighter aircraft. The question is whether China and Chinese social scientists are going to produce categories of thought that the rest of us will be working with. That would be the emergence of a world power, it seems to me. I don't see that anywhere on the horizon at all at the moment, not even remotely. So I think I'd end there. Thank you.
I want to pick up on this knowledge systems. I'll use the word epistemologies.
Yes.
Now, I don't want to appear like I'm putting you in a corner, but you don't reside in the West, do you?
What's that, sorry?
You don't reside in the West, do you?
I do.
Okay.
I
so
do.
You
I mean, I reside both places.
Someone who might be able to answer this question.
Yeah.
You know, after Syed's book, and in the flurry, you know, of work on it by people like, what's his name, Gauri Vishwanathan, all
yeah.
his disciples.
Masks of
Congress. There's been actually a kind of a reaction to the work of people, the intellectuals, Indian intellectuals particularly, who reside in the West as neo-Orientalists.
Yeah.
I don't know what your take is on this, because it's actually affected the way in which a lot of the literature in the
yeah.
field
yeah.
is now viewed through the prism of people like Spivak, you know. And it's, you know, in a way you're also part of that intellectual diaspora. I don't know the word, but it's worrisome. And now the Indians, of course, Indian intellectuals, are taking this on and viewing it through their own eyes as it's a kind of a dirty word, like these intellectuals are in a way students of the West because they're articulating the same epistemologies, or at least forwarding the epistemologies. That's one thing. The other thing is, I just want to ask you very quickly, but I don't want to interrupt you. This Ayn Rand is the lady who wrote that book, isn't it, The Virtue of Selfishness?
That's
a philosophical.
But actually, I don't know. I've heard of that work. I don't know if she actually wrote it as such or if it's a compilation from the other book. But that's basically our.
When you said novelist, I thought.
But the argument is about selfishness. As I said, unmitigated, unchecked greed, the advancement of self-interest. Yes.
So anyway, to link what you said with periodization, there's a real problem now. I think, from my limited understanding. In relation to philosophies, for instance, how because of periodization and invocation of the words of concepts like religion and God from the West, basically, you see, there is a kind of a lacuna, in relation to Eastern philosophies.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't know where to place them, and if you talk about like Sarvapalli Radhakrishnan or even Sai Anathas, it's as if they are like footnotes, in relation to a main phrase that is already universal. But universal for whom?
Yeah.
I know these are all just ideas, but I wondered if you could respond first to this
notion
that people like you are part of the neo-orientalists. Would you take kindly to that, or would you defend
it? No. I mean, we can have a discussion on that. That's not an issue at all for me. But let me actually begin with the second one, quickly, and then move to the question of Orientalism and scholars in India and so on. The question of Eastern philosophy and so on. You see, look, I think I would suggest the following.
Very quickly, Bernard Lewis, ironically, is the one who actually denounced periodization.
Yeah.
Funny enough.
Okay. You see that I'm going to give you short answers because I can speak about both of these at some length. But the short answer to the question about Eastern philosophy and so on is this. Let's begin first with Western universities. Okay. When you study Eastern philosophy in the United States or Britain or Germany, you do not study it in a philosophy department. Let us be very clear about that. You study it in a South Asian studies department, not in a philosophy department. Okay? Because, frankly, from their point of view, that's not philosophy. And that is true of every discipline. A good illustration of that is music. The university where I have had a position since 1993, UCLA, has the world's largest ethnomusicology department, ethnomusicology. It also has a music department. Music, however, department means Western classical music. That's what it means. Ethnomusicology includes the music of the Malay world, the music of India, the music of Africa. Then it becomes ethno. Just like your science or my science, the science produced here or India, becomes ethnoscience. It's not science. It's ethnoscience. Okay? It's a simple distinction, but this is how it has worked in the West for a very long period of time. From the point of view of the West, by the way, Indian philosophy means things like, from the popular, means things like yoga. That's what Indian philosophy means. Of course, they don't know that Indian philosophical systems are much older than any philosophical system in the West. Except that the people who do the professional study of Indian philosophy, as I said, they don't belong in philosophy departments in the West. Now, in India, the situation is actually quite tragic too, because you would think, at least in India, we would recognize our own philosophy. If you look at the philosophy curriculum of most university departments in India, the bulk of it is Western philosophy. Okay? Usually beginning with Aristotle, although there's Western philosophy before Aristotle and Plato, they're the pre-Socratics, for example, okay? But they don't usually do that. And then most of it will actually be 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th century, Hume, Berkeley, Locke, and then moving on into existentialism, that kind of thing. Okay?
Because Indian philosophy would be subsumed under religion. You see, that's
no,
problem.
No, because Indian universities don't have religion studies departments. The religion is a very much a Western trope of thought.
Yeah.
You see, we don't have religion studies departments. And that's a separate problem altogether because this idea of religion is something that we would have to look at, because basically when we speak, say, religion, in the early 19th century, Protestant Christianity became the template for the idea of religion. And that's been a fundamental problem for religions all over the world, because every religion tried to model itself in some sense or the other after 19th century Protestant Christianity, because that became the template for what we call religion. Okay? But that's going to be a large subject in itself. To go back to your first question, no, you see, the way I would look at it is this, that, you know, we would have to segment it into several different parts. The first part has to do with the location of post-colonial scholars, mainly in the West, which is what you're referring to. And there was a critique of that, which, if you're not familiar with, I would alert you to, by Ejaz Ahmed. Ejaz Ahmed made a critique of that in a book called In Theory. And the critique is basically about post-colonial thought basically being the thought of scholars living in exile or in the diaspora. Okay? Right? Which would include, obviously, Edward Said and Gayatri Spivak and the third member of that holy trinity, as I call it, Bobby Baba. Okay? Right? You know, who is also, who is now at Harvard, right? So these three were the three main people. Indians are actually centrally involved. Said, of course, is not an Indian, but Indians are centrally involved, because where post-colonial thought became most productive and led to the most interesting studies was in Indian studies. Was in Indian studies, and there was one view of it was that subordinate studies was the Indian variant of subordinate studies, of post-colonial studies. But that's, again, you know, to really get into it would require a good deal of time to look at the particular genealogy of it and so forth and so on. I think what I would say is that, in fact, Said's influence and the influence of subordinate studies became very profound in India itself. And one reason why your argument would be hard to accept for many is that the bulk of the people who were involved in it, including the practitioners of subordinate studies, were working within India. Many of, some of them might have had training overseas.
No, they publications, I agree with you.
Yeah, no, no, but the bulk of the scholars who were involved in what is called subordinate studies, okay, the bulk of these scholars were working within the Indian context, okay, and in fact, it was very clear, although this is where I disagree, I mean, in some sense, I agree with you, that the categories of thought that they were using were all taken from the West. So in other words, subordinate studies, what it did was it changed the style of thinking about how we study history. Right, but it still used Foucault and Gramsci and Derrida. These were the main sources. You know, the post-structuralist thinkers, the post-Marxist thinkers, these were the main sources. So India was still, in the 19th century term, the place that you mine for raw data. Okay, you simply do your field work there or your archival work, but the theoretical models were still coming from the West. Okay, now I want to add a little bit more to this. And this is where it goes to the question of what is distinct about Said. Okay? Because an argument has often been made. For example, a friend of mine who wrote a book, his name is Ziauddin Sardar, he wrote a book called Orientalism. He's a very well-known Muslim intellectual living in Britain. Okay? Now, when Zia wrote this book called Orientalism, I mean, he makes the argument that, look, there is an Egyptian scholar by the name of Anwar Abdel Malik, who wrote a piece called Orientalism and Crisis, 1956. This is 22 years before Said published Orientalism. Orientalism published in 1978. Okay. Said Hussein Alatas's, well, it was 77, so it was around the same time, The Myth of the Lazy Naked, but there's a huge difference. And this is where I don't agree with my friend. There's a huge difference between what Said was doing and what Anwar Abdel Malik or Said Hussein Alatas were doing. We have to understand what the difference is. And the difference can be encapsulated in the following way. You see, Said is not simply saying that Western intellectuals have had, or Western scholars or Western travelers have had prejudices about the rest of the world. He's not simply saying that. And that these prejudices contaminated the scholarship. Because after all, for centuries before that, right? We had exactly the same kinds of prejudices being displayed, right? So if Dante, you go back to an author like Dante, in the Inferno, where is the place for the prophet?
Yes.
in heaven.
In heaven.
Right? So he had that view. Dante had that view. So was Dante, quote, an Orientalist then? Right? Or if you go back much before Dante to Herodotus, the Greek historian writing in the 6th century BC, I mean, when he writes about Indians or Persians, I mean, he writes in the most fanciful way. You know, they're half animal, half human, almost kind of arguments, right? So was he an Orientalist? No. Because Said is making a very different argument. He is making an argument where he's suggesting there is an intrinsic relationship between Orientalism and colonialism. That Orientalism of the kind that he's talking about only becomes possible during the colonial period. So there are two things we have to keep in mind, if you accept that. One, that the nature of representation of the other became institutionalized in the 18th century. It was not institutionalized before. It was some random author here or there saying something about the Indians or the Persians or the Africans, whether it was Dante or Herodotus or whatever. In the 18th century, a whole institutional apparatus arose for the representation of the other. Because Orientalism is a theory about the politics of representation. Okay? The other way to talk about this is to say that there is a huge difference in reading Said along with Foucault and not reading him along with Foucault. In other words, Foucault becomes very important for Said's argument. Okay? Becomes very important for Said's argument because Foucault basically has an argument where he says that there are certain epistemes which become critical in Western modernity. So Said's basically saying, not simply that it became institutionalized, but it became an episteme. That is, this form of representation became an episteme. Right? It acquires a kind of an ontological ground of its own, which is no longer contested anymore in the late 18th century. And this is something that was not at all clear to Said Hussein Al-Attas when he was writing, or when Anwar Abdul Malik was writing, or when K.M. Panikkar was writing, a book he wrote called Asia and Western Dominance, published in 1953, in fact. Okay? Wonderful book. But the argument is not identical to Said. There's obvious overlapping. Because the politics of representation, as Said talks about it, acquires a different epistemological force. And I think this is where the Indian academics more or less agreed that, yes, this is where Said was actually different from what had preceded before. Because if you're going to do anti-colonial critiques, India had great examples. Mohandas Gandhi had understood Western knowledge systems, but he wasn't somebody who was a scholar, you know, right, who's going to churn out a tract. But if you read Gandhi's writings, which are enormous, I hope you know how enormous, there are 100 volumes, right, of his collected works. And if you read Gandhi, you can see the critique of colonialism and the critique of knowledge systems, but it's tacit. It's simply in an incipient form. It's not systematized.
Any more questions?
No. Thank you for the explanation. You presented so many ideas. And I'm not knocking anybody. I'm just saying that this is a phenomenon in relation to your own admission that epistemology evolved.
Yeah.
You know, because of this, kind of periodization. But the other thing is about America, for example. You know, I mean, I take your point, of course, we're all aware. Basically, I come from the, basically, my cognitive linguistics and I wonder elsewhere. If you look at applied linguistics, for example, it's actually academic imperialism because, you know, the Americans, when they created, when there was a need, for example, to understand the rest of the world, they created all these language labs, you know.
Yes.
And out of that, you had applied linguistics. And many people don't understand that the whole TESOL and EFL and ELT industry is actually playing into the hands of another kind of imperialism.
Oh, absolutely.
And sociology. Now, I'm going to disagree my agreement with you. Sociology, the very fundamental nature of sociology was a creation. The social sciences were actually created by the Americans too.
Yeah.
Just, again, in relation to categorization. So it is very
But I'm
compelling.
Quite clear about that. In fact, I mean,
your
arguments
are very
compelling,
and I want to know where I can read your particular paper. Can you?
No, in fact, the practices of the social sciences has been borrowed lock, stock, and barrel, frankly, from the West.
Yeah.
And, you know, and whether it's Malaysia or India or Africa, doesn't make the slightest difference, frankly. Just been completely taken over from there. Now, in India, there you have various kinds of resistance movements coming out, sometimes from the ground, which are actually more interesting to look at from the point of view of how they try to contest, you know, some of these dominant frameworks of knowledge. But they haven't entered the realm of the university at all.
Look, carry on. I mean, I just wanted to leave it, if that's available.
Okay, I'm sharing out with you. Okay, let me tell you my own experience. I mean, you're talking about categories, China and category. Price of China, whether you come up with categories. And well, I agree with you, I do not believe in China. Chinese coming up with new categories. Right? Because my experience with Chinese is that they are so keen to learn about the West.
Yeah.
Everything about the West, right? Not just in technology, but also, for example, I've met Chinese academics who are coming to Germany to study about Marx. Right? I was very surprised. Okay? But in my discussions with them, I also posed them such a question. I said that, you know, China and East Asia has got its own philosophical tradition, right? Whether it's Confucianism or beyond
that.
Yeah. And I always ask the question, how come they have not developed it? Right? Develop it further. I mean, if you look at Western philosophy, you can talk about, you know, so many kinds, so many philosophies and so many strengths, and you know, that's a development, right?
Yeah.
How come in China, you know, that's never happened? What is it? Because it's one thing always to blame the West that, right, you impose your ideas on us, the imperialism is there.
Yeah.
But what you have you done? On the other side, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The Chinese, for example, I think of China, they are the biggest country.
Yes.
You have the mass, right? The people mass. What's wrong with them? What happened in Chinese history that, you know, Chinese development that they never came up, they never developed beyond Confucianism or some Taoism or Leism there is. That's what I'm wondering.
Okay. Well, you know, look, I will not be able to give you an opinion on, you know, whether the Chinese developed schools of philosophical thought beyond Confucianism and to what degree they did it or didn't do it, because I'm not sufficiently knowledgeable about that. If you ask me about Indian philosophy, I could.
Yeah, but
and I could tell you that Indian philosophical schools of thought are much more extensive than any philosopher in the West could ever have dreamt of. In fact, T.S. Eliot, the great poet of the wasteland, was in his early days a scholar of Sanskrit, okay? And when he started reading the Sanskrit grammarians and logicians, he wrote that the philosophical texts of the Buddhists and the Hindus make the great European philosophers look like schoolboys. This is an exact quotation from T.S. Eliot, okay? And by the way, we are so colonized that I always have, that we have to eventually quote some great author from there, you see, to counter. Think. Look at it this way.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
But it's a way of answering the question, of course, that in the case of China, I couldn't give you an answer, but I do know that there are philosophical schools of thought in India which I think have an enormous complexity. But I want to broaden that question out to two other questions. Mm-hmm. With, you know, I want to extrapolate from that, if you permit me, because I think that's where we perhaps ought to be thinking about it. Okay, one is that, you see, we have to understand, and this is why I brought in the example of the Indian Ocean world, that we had cultural exchanges with each other which did not involve the West. And these cultural and intellectual exchanges predate our encounter with the West. And when I say our, I mean both the Malay world and China and India and Africa. The links between India and the Southeast Asia, and you know, and I'm very candid. I'll say that openly, but I think that's a problem in Malaysia today.
Yes.
Okay, and I know that from, because I come here frequently. I read about Malaysia. For example, they've done archaeological digs in Malaysia and Indonesia where they have found evidence of Hindu civilization going back to 5th century AD. And immediately the funds for these archaeological digs dry up. It's happened in Indonesia, it's happened in Malaysia. I think it's extremely unfortunate. Because it also shows, you see, that we conversed and exchanged ideas which did not involve the West at all. And in fact, we were able to do it without using the kind of violence that was involved when the encounter with the West took place. Because we have to remember that the encounter with the West was invariably, for everybody involved in it, a bloody encounter. And for some people, it was disastrous, such as the Australian Aboriginals, the Native Americans, people who were entirely wiped out, exterminated, frankly. So we were able to have conversations with each other which did not involve the West. Now we need to rehabilitate these conversations. And we cannot do it, by the way, simply by officially sponsored exchanges. So, you know, a program in Delhi showing, you know, the folk dances of Laos and Malaysia. No, that's not going to do it, sorry. Because these are officially sanctioned forms of cultural exchange which are meaningless, frankly. We need to read each other. We need to see whether, in fact, there are epistemological, ontological issues in each other's works which address us in a different way. Okay? That's one thing. The second element that I would like to take your argument into, because that's implicit in your argument, is an argument that what distinguishes the West, and you may not have meant it that way, but I think that this is where it will be taken by Western scholars. What distinguishes the West ultimately from everybody else is that the West has the capacity for self-correction and self-growth. That, you know, the West continued to grow. We, on the other hand, became stagnant. And there are variations of this argument. One variation of this argument is that, well, yes, you know, we committed atrocities, but now we apologize for it. And this is what distinguishes the West from Japan, which will not, okay, apologize. Frankly, these apologies are meaningless because then you go and destroy some other country, which is what they've done in Iraq and Afghanistan, right? There's an epidemic of apologies, frankly, in the last 2 decades. I mean, the West has been apologizing for God knows everything, you know. We're very sorry we did this, we're very sorry for eliminating your people, for racism, this and that. But those attitudes haven't changed. And they cannot change unless the manner in which the West thinks about the other undergoes a radical transformation. The West has always had a difficult time with the other. I'm not suggesting that other cultures haven't. Every culture has a difficult time with the other. But I think the West had a much more brutal way of dealing with it than everybody else did. And that's my own view of the matter. And some people might say there's, you know, shades of indigenism in it or whatever. But I think that it can be substantiated by the literature, which is again another reason why the Indian Ocean word is a very interesting word, because in India, that Indian Ocean word was destroyed when Vasco da Gama came and brought cannon on his ships, which was never done in the Indian Ocean world. I mean, all the histories of the Indian Ocean world are very clear about that. Okay? But he brought cannon, and the cannon was used, and frankly, the West engaged in brutal, wholesale kidnapping and murder. That's what they did. You know. That was a history with which colonialism began.
So now the other question that I just the point, the time lag. No?
Time lag, yes.
Well, if I still remember, this whole question is a question of a linear conception of development.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Which is opposed also to a much more circular concept of the mind. In the piece, right?
Yeah.
Now, what I'm also struck by is that we Asians, we have imbibed this linear concept of development.
Yeah.
Of time. Okay? This is about time, right?
Temporality.
Yeah, right?
Temporality.
Yeah. But at the same time, somewhere in our back of our minds, we are also living in this circular mind. Somewhere, right? And we have hard times in trying to adjust ourselves.
Yeah.
Okay. Look, I say this because, in fact, it was brought to my notice by a European, okay? Because I have a German friend. who's teaching Sanskrit in Germany, okay, and who also teaches in India Sanskrit, right? And of course, it's unusual for somebody who, you know, I mean, it's very rare for me to see a European who actually, a young European, and not the point, you know. So, and he was the one who pointed out this fact to me. Now, what I want to say is this. How can we, perhaps much more in India than in China or elsewhere, that to rediscover this consciousness of the differences here,
yes,
and how we can build on it?
Well, you know, that's a very large,
I know,
you know, question, because I mean, you know,
yeah,
by the way, the linear versus the circular, I have reservations about that.
Yeah.
That was one of the characteristic ways in which European thought talked about us.
Yeah.
That we don't have
monochromic,
a linear way of thinking, and rationality is linear, okay, you know, so forth and so on. I would like to put it in a different framework, that there are different orders of temporality.
Okay.
There are different orders of temporality, and the question is, how did the Western order of temporality impinge upon other orders of temporality? Right? And then that would, by the way, involve many different things. It would involve looking at temporality both in long units and in short units. Okay. So when I say long units, I'm talking about, for example, centuries, periodization that I spoke about, is a form of temporality, of course, right? Ancient, medieval, modern, right? But sometimes it's very clear that we think of things within the modern world which we say really are ancient. So if somebody behaves in a barbaric way, we say, oh, you know, this person's not modern at all, right? Okay? You see, the problem there, of course, is why should we assume that that's actually pre-modern? In fact, modern forms of barbarism have been much more brutal. Right? And which is why the 20th century is instructive, because there has never been a period in human history where the concept of total war was conducted with as much license as it was in the 20th century. Right? And it's not simply because we don't have the documentation. We have good documentation for 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th centuries. But the concept of total war that developed in the 20th century is without comparison. It's without comparison. So, obviously, there are different ways of contesting these temporality, and one way to contest this order of temporality is to suggest that the modern may not actually be all that modern in many ways. Okay, but again, the difficulty there is that it still involves the notion of the modern, which can only be understood within a certain framework of temporality. Right. So the question now is whether we can come up with categories of thought which would dispense with that kind of temporality. Right? And so this would involve then restructuring the way in which we organize our knowledge entirely. So why should we have university departments which are based on disciplines such as anthropology? Anthropology, by the way, is an entirely temporal discipline. Because you study people who are underdeveloped. You don't study your own people. The anthropology is the study of the other. And the other, Americans don't study the British. They study, you know, the Indians and the Malays, you know, right? And the Africans and the Polynesians, that's what they study. It's the other who is supposed to be underdeveloped. And of course, anthropology is temporal in another way, that anthropology is born under the sign of colonialism. There is no anthropology without colonialism, yeah, right? So why do we even have an anthropology department to begin with, frankly, you know, in universities in Malaysia or India or countries like that? Why do we even have an anthropology department? We have to radically rethink. And that's the answer to the question about, you know, about how we are going to reorganize the framework of knowledge we have, and so on. Yeah.
Two quick. One is a question, one is a comment.
Yeah.
The phrase that you use, resident non-Indian.
Yeah.
I think there are a lot of resident non-Malaysian here.
Oh, I'm sure.
Yeah,
sure.
Especially after 1980, well, even historically, where people were trained,
yeah,
a lot of them went to train in the West, especially,
yeah,
Europe and so on. But also in the late 70s, when the government policy was to send a bunch of students outside of the country, and when they came back, you know, I think I'm one of the product of that.
We're all guilty.
Policy. So, and you know, I think that can be found not just across the country, but even in Malaysia, in the middle class, you can see a bunch of those as well.
Yeah.
Now, my question is actually with regards to your point on the radical organization of knowledge after the Second World War.
Yeah.
With regards to area studies, because this is something that is also going through the different universities. So maybe I'd like to pick your brain on in terms of your take with regards to, you know, the division of this area studies discipline, whether we should go by area studies, we should go by thematic studies, or in some other places, what kind of knowledge system is there in terms of rearranging local knowledge, whatever that might mean. So, you know, in the time where actually even UKM and other places, before this we had a big exercise with the Faculty of Social Sciences, but you may even be going through at the institute level. Maybe some of your thoughts with regards to this radical organization of knowledge.
Yeah, right. Hmm. Well, okay, so, you know, the radical reorganization of knowledge that took place, I was very clear, took place with respect to this question of area studies, because of course what happened was that in the traditional disciplines got consolidated, in fact, after World War II. So it's not as if anthropology and sociology and economics, you know, disappeared, not at all, they got consolidated. But there was an Americanization, which is crucial. Okay, which I didn't really speak about. So, for example, in the case of economics, I have a quote in this paper, actually. One of the, if you look at one of the key works of economics in the 1940s, John Maynard Keynes' work, it is actually a work of English prose. If you read Keynes, it's like reading English prose. It's like reading literature. When the discipline becomes Americanized, it also becomes mathematized. Gradually, the size of the economics dissertation went from 300 pages to 40 pages. That's the average size of an economics PhD dissertation today, 40 pages, because it is almost entirely models, equations.
Parametric.
Almost entirely. Okay? This is one of the consequences of the Americanization of these disciplines. The same argument can be made for virtually every discipline. You know, she was mentioning applied linguistics, you know, political science.
Yeah.
Political science has become much more mathematized. The best political scientists now try to pass themselves off as economists, fundamentally. Because economics is higher up on the social ladder. And in America, by the way, you get paid depending on the discipline you're in. So economists get paid much higher wages than historians and political scientists. Most people don't know that. That's the case, you know, because they are considered to be the top, because it's the one that most approximates a science from their point of view. I think it's witchcraft, frankly. I've written about that. I think economics is witchcraft.
And drives the global economy.
Okay. Yeah. But basically, they think it's science, and that's why the Nobel Prize is called the Nobel Prize in Economic Science. Not just economics, economic science. Okay. The way I would really like to look at it is this, however. It's not like I've thought through it and have a blueprint for what a university would be like, you know, but think about it. For example, one of the things that's been important in all civilization is the notion of elements. How people think about the elements, how you think about fire, how you think about air, how you think about the soil. Now, we do have departments where you study the air, where you study water, but these are very specialized departments. A department of hydrology is the study of water. But this is water as the engineer who dams a river thinks about it. Okay? I think that is disastrous. Because in every civilization, these elements, I'm just giving you one illustration. There may be other sets of categories that we might want to think about. In every civilization, right, the place of these elements is critical in ways that sometimes is purely unconscious. If you look at India, for example, fire, okay? I mean, the Hindu marriage ceremony takes place around a fire. In the Vedas, the fire, the oblation, the sacrifice was done around the fire. One of the ways in which protest has taken place in India, the most visible way is when somebody comes and immolates himself or herself, burns himself or herself, okay, on the street. Right? Now, I think we should think about creating departments where, for example, we say, there'll be a department of water, where you will have the engineers and the humanists and the poets. I'm writing a book right now. It's called The Poetics, Politics, and Aesthetics of Water. Okay? Where I'm looking at how water has been thought about in India for thousands of years by, you know, poets, writers, you name it. Because water is so critical. And there, it's critical in different cultures and different ways. You know, so in India, there are bodies of water that are considered to be pure. They, if you do a physical test, it's completely contaminated. So if you're a Hindu, you know, you have to go to Banaras if you're an Orthodox Hindu. And there is this idea of what's called Ganga Jal. Ganga Jal means the water of the Ganga. And you're supposed to give a sip of it to a person, okay, at the end, because it purifies them. If you actually do a chemical test of the water, it's completely contaminated. But that doesn't matter, because that's not the way in which belief or faith works. Okay? There are bodies of water which are critical. We have in fact, in some ways, rendered our bodies of water into divinities. They're worshipped. Right? And then on the other hand, of course, you have water in the way in which a hydrologist or an engineer studies it. Now, we talk about interdisciplinary work, but frankly, the way interdisciplinary work is done today, it's a sham. Because all it really means is you use the follies of two different disciplines and replicate the follies of both disciplines in your work. You know, from what I've seen of interdisciplinary work. What would be really interesting would be if you had, let's say, a department of water studies. And you give it an indigenous term. You won't call it water. If in India, you'll call it jal or whatever, right? Right? You know, department of air studies. And then we see, okay, how is it that we think about it? And everybody who works on this question, doesn't matter whether you're a scientist or a poet or a social scientist, you belong there. That's one way to organize knowledge. Okay? That's one way to organize it. Because the elements, after all, are critical in the way in which we think about the world. Right? That might be one set of categories you might use. Another set of categories might be aesthetic categories. Right? I mean, if you were studying the concept of beauty, for example, right? Now you could be doing it in an art department right now, or you could be studying it as a literary scholar, right? But clearly there is something that a sociologist or an anthropologist in it that might be something that they might be able to bring into the study of a concept such as beauty or truth, right? Right? So this might be one set of concepts that you could use to organize studies. It's possible. I don't know. We'd have to think about how we're going to create a university which will be set on entirely different principles, because certainly the way in which the university is set up today, I think the university in the global south has been an unmitigated disaster, frankly. Almost everywhere in the global south. We are just producing people who are almost entirely mimicking what is happening over there. And what's happening there is not very good because of the whole complicity of powers, structures of power, colonialism, and all of that over the course of the last 300-400 years. So even though I might be the graduate of some of the fine American universities, I don't hold them in high esteem at all. And I made myself very clear on this issue back there as well, that I think that there's a fundamental problem in the way in which universities organize their knowledge. And I would remind you of something that we have completely forgotten. And here again, you look up the Oxford English Dictionary. It's really fascinating. If you go to the word university, one of the meanings is the meaning that we expect there. That is an institution of higher education. If you look up meanings B, C, D, E, and the Oxford English Dictionary tells you that all of these have now become obsolete in the English language, these meanings. Meanings B, C, D, E are... The university meant all creation. The word itself, that was the definition. The universe. The universe. Okay? We have to bring the universe back. We have to bring that older meaning back into the university. Because the university can only claim that meaning by pretending that it surveys and studies everything. But in fact, of course, this is where the second problem comes in, that the university is also known as a place of ivory tower intellectuals, people who have cut themselves off from the universe. This is where the public intellectual comes in. The public intellectual has to bridge the universe with the university. That's one way of defining what a public intellectual should be doing today. Right? And the public intellectual has virtually disappeared, even from the West, frankly. I mean, France probably had the most well-known examples. People like, you know, Jean-Paul Sartre, who was a public intellectual. Foucault was a public intellectual, you know. In the United States, Edward Said was, okay? But, you know, these are a handful of people, frankly. You know, and who would be a public intellectual, for example, in Malaysia? Nah, not that I know all the leading figures here, but I know something since I come here and look at it. I can't think of anybody who I would refer to as a public intellectual in that sense.
Because
who
of government
bridges.
Intervention.
Sorry?
Because of government intervention, the government intervenes.
Yeah, no, but that's certainly the case. But it also has to do with the fact that scholars themselves largely don't feel responsible for the universe. You feel responsible to practitioners in your own field. That's why you write articles for peer-reviewed journals. There are some of us who have stopped doing that, by the way, completely. Stopped doing that. And the reason I come to Malaysia often is that we set up a group called Multiversity. You know, and so it's a group of scholars and intellectuals from the global south, and we meet in Penang every 2 years. Okay, and it includes intellectuals from India, Africa, and so on. Okay, some from Malaysia, a few from Malaysia as well. And one of the things is that all of us, and not all of us hold high positions at the best American universities. I mean, there are a few people who do, but most of them don't, or most of them work entirely within India or Africa or whatever the case might be, is that we don't believe that you have to legitimize yourself always by publishing in peer-reviewed journals, you know, getting cited in the Social Science Citation Index, you know. These are all ways in which we continue to be completely colonized, frankly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we have to stop.
Yeah.
You can continue.
Yeah.